Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Let us sing Feeling So Much Better, page 9.
Feeling so much better, talking about this good old way. Feeling so much better, talking about the Lord. Let's go on, talking about this good old way. Let's go on, talking about the Lord. The devil, he don't like it, talking about this good old way. The devil, he don't like it, talking about the Lord. Let's go on, talking about this good old way. So let's go on, talking about the Lord. Feeling so much better, talking about this good old way. Feeling so much better, talking about the Lord. Let's go on, talking about this good old way. Let's go on, talking about the Lord.
Let's stand as Brother Paul comes up for prayer requests. Sister Gwen's mom is doing much better today, and she may actually come home today. Brother Richard Marlowe says to please pray for Sarah Marlowe's grandmother, Gigi, that they have her on a feeding tube, and she is very sick. Brother Mark also says that Gary Smith, Ashley Presley's little brother, and Corey Dyer got hit head-on last night, and the details are a little sketchy. Gary was operated on at 3 a.m. He seemed stable. Corey needs a real touch from the Lord to make it. Brother Colley, can you please pray?
Lord, knowing that you will answer our prayers, God, as we believe and we pray. Lord, these requests, these praying, Lord, as we believe. Lord, you just deliver these, Lord, that are sick. Remember Sister Gwen's mother. Remember those five that are in the wreck. Lord, just remember everyone that had prayer requests for them. Lord, all that had prayers in their heart. Lord, we ask you just grant them that they are in need of. God, the best of service in a special way, in Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Let's turn to page 61 and sing I Shall Not Be Moved.
Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is my Savior. I shall not be moved. In His love and favor, I shall not be moved. That's great. just like a tree that's planted by the waters. I shall not be moved.
Sister Monica's Sunday school classes, please come up for our special. And let's sing "He Is Everything to Me," page 70.
He's everything, he's everything to me. He's everything, he's everything. My mother, my sister, and my brother. He's everything to me.
precious life he gave, and now he's alive, and there's an empty grave.
Brother Ben, Benjamin, please come up for this time to take up the offering. While we take up the offering, let's sing Glad Day, page 530. Let's all pray. Lord God, thank you for this day, and thank you for everything you've done for us, Lord. I pray that you'll bless this offering wherever it may go, Lord. And please bless this service this evening, Lord. In your name, amen.
Special. Rachel won't and be won't get all I week.
Sing Fill My Way With Love, page 28.
Let me walk, blessed Lord, in the way thou hast gone, leading straight to the land above, giving sad and alone. Fill my way every day with love. Fill my way every day with love. As I walk with the heavenly love, let me go all the while with a song and a smile. Fill my way every day with love. Savior and God, let me never in darkness roam. Keep my path free from wrath and my soul satisfied. Fill my way every day with love. Fill my way every day with love. As I walk with the heavenly dove,
stand to our feet and change to the order of the service as we sing Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Holy, holy, holy,
amen.
shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Be loving. See him, then he's capable of being seen, because that's the desire, right? And it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Good to see everybody. If you'd like to turn in your scriptures, we're going to be reading from Revelation 1, and then we're going to Ezekiel 36. Revelation 1, Ezekiel 36. Now remember, Brother Luis will be preaching this coming Wednesday, the Lord willing. Then the Bible study will be this coming Saturday, 6 o'clock. Then Brother Pekash will be with us on Wednesday, the 6th of May. And then the Father's Day fishing trip. The times are together and the 4th of July. And the meeting's coming up. So remember all of these. Amen. And just pray that the Lord would be with each one. Amen. Let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We love you. We desire one thing from you, and that is to be able to understand what you're trying to say unto us. And it was brought unto us by way of the prophet messenger, so we don't have to worry about it, whose word it is. We know whose it is. It's your word. And we pray that you would just bless us and give us understanding ears to hear, Lord. And you'd do as we were singing, that you would open the eyes of our heart, that, Lord, we may see you. Forgive our sins. Lead us by thine understanding. And just direct us in your love and grace, in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll go to Revelation 1. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. In the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. Right. Now, we should be catching on that that's part of what we're covering now, because we've come through the bringing up to the New Testament form, and then talking about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And that's what these things are talking about, the description of him during that time. Now let's go to Ezekiel 36, and we'll read. We'll go to verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and give you an heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. You may be seated. The Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word. Now, I've got a couple announcements to make and a couple of little things to say before we get into the message. So, you know, bear with me a moment and think about it. Now, we've observed sometimes the kids outside, and kids, we're very proud of you, and we know you're kids, and we know you act like kids, and we're not condemning you for acting like kids, but we are a church, and we have to handle things to make sure, you know, that we can be safe and everything going right. So now, kids, I know you play sometimes pretty rough. I've even gotten on to you a few times myself about running around with sticks that are sharpened off and pointing at each other. You know, the boys, now the girls don't do that too much, but boys, they, you know, they get into a lot of things. But be careful, because you can get hurt. You could hurt somebody, and it wouldn't be no good of saying, well, it wasn't my fault. That won't put an eye back in a socket. It won't cause something to heal up that's hurting and damaged for life. So what you're playing and your doings and, you know, stay basically on our playground. Don't be going over on the other part, even it's a good parking lot over there. But don't be going over there, because the one main thing is, if you go over there, we can't say nothing if they come over here. And that's why I instruct you not to play basketball at a certain time when we meet here, and you've kind of got away from that. But like on Wednesdays and things, don't play ball, and on Sunday mornings and things, don't play ball out there, because it invites other kids to come and want to play and all like that. And we don't care about doing, but we don't want nobody to have problems and things. The playground is there for you to use, but use it rightfully in the doing. So don't go over there and play in theirs, and don't go up in front of the building, up in over here. I've seen a lot of you do it. You have been known to get up on the air conditioner machines out there and been standing out there on things. And, you know, just kind of cool it down just a little bit on the basis of not being too doing. And now, Mama and Daddy, I've always told you, you know, if somebody comes and tells you that your kids are doing things, don't you get upset with them, because they're told of me to do it, especially to instruct the deacons to kind of mull around a little bit in between in different parts of the service, and for them to correct the children and have them to do things correctly, you know, and play correctly and not be into the dangers of anything, because we don't want somebody to get hurt. We try our best to have you the playgrounds to where you can do. We've got three sections of playgrounds and, you know, slides and different things. So try to do it according to the right order. And when you're out there, you know, the little bitty ones, they're over here playing down on their bottom part of it over there and of the playground. And, you know, don't be running backwards and forth by them and all and running and doing, because you're going to hurt somebody. And, you know, you don't, Mama didn't want you hurt when you was little. But now mommies and daddies remember that, okay? Remember, you didn't want your kids hurt. You know, well, they're you know, they're grown, some of them grown up now, but still that doesn't make things in the right order for you to do. So just kind of, you know, control yourselves and not being too rough and playing with the kids. And we haven't got a set order that these have got to play here and these have got to play here and that one there. We do have a set order of little ones about them, and the next group is the older ones, and the bigger kids needs to stay up on this top end up here. And you have your own things and doings, and, you know, and let some of the kids play, and they're out there, you know, take care of each other. Don't be harmful to each other. You say, well, they're not up here where they're not here where we are. Well, then go get somebody and let them direct them out of the way and make sure everything's all right. Keep it going in a safe and a sane manner, you know, to where you can do. And, you know, have everything in decently in order. Now, we have a little problem with one thing that we need to cover, that sometimes kids are kids, but they are a little bit on the wrong side about being kids. And sometimes they kind of make light of each other or whatever. And, you know, don't do that, kids. Don't think because you are one race that you can make fun of another race. Brother Dale will get upset with you in a hurry when you start trying to do those things, because that's not correct. Everybody is the same here. It's not, you know, that we have a this or we have a that or we have a Dale clan and nobody else is not allowed. The reason the Dale clan's in charge of a lot of things is because they will do their jobs, offices and things, and, you know, a lot of you wouldn't take the job, so somebody's got to do it. So it's not that. But don't be making light of nobody, Because just remember, you make light of somebody, somebody gonna make light of you. And you know, it's not fun. It's not doings. It's not nice to do anything contrary to one to the other of the kids. All of you kids are the same. And kids are good. They can get over it and all like that. But it still hurts feelings for the kids sometimes to, you know, maybe pull a little back and play themselves and don't let the others. Everybody play together. We try to make a playground where you can play together and have a good time and all like that. But just let it be that you'll do it in order and not making no points of separating in sides, you know, to pull away or to do anything. And, you know, you'd say, well, they don't want to play with me. Well, then next day you won't want to play with them. So that's kids. But that shouldn't be. We're trying to be Christians. You know, children, we're trying to be Christians. And you get somebody come in and they see you doing little things and that doesn't work too good, especially when you're kind of yakety-yakety over and pull aside and get your little groups and parties and things. You shouldn't do that. As a matter of fact, I have tried to contact the person, and even I did this morning. We had one sister that is not coming to church now. And one of the reasons she's not coming is because her granddaughter was offended by some things somebody here said to her. Some of the girls and boys or somebody said something to the girl and made her upset, and she doesn't want to come to this church. Well, now, you that done that or whatever you done, you need to straighten things up because that's your responsibility. You know, you're responsible for that person. You say, oh, they just, well, that's right, but what would it be if it was your child? What would you do if it was your child? See, it changes if we switch it around on the other side of the fence, you know. Makes things a little bit different if we swap it over, you know, in doing. But, you know, I'm trying to contact the person because we knew they had stopped, but not no reason. But, you know, and I've always been, if you leave here, don't expect me to call you, you know, because I'm not going to beg you to come back. And I wouldn't try to beg anyone to do that, but I just felt obligated to, if something was said by somebody here, an action or reaction that would be anything derogatory to the right order, it needs to be dealt with here. So, you know, if you just remember tomorrow is your day. You know, that's the best way to say it. Tomorrow is your day. That somebody will be, you'll have problems. Well, then you're going to say, well, you know, I didn't do. Well, you know, just try to be in the right order and get everything into the point to where that everybody can do. Because we're trying to win people to the Lord. And you can't win people to the Lord if you're making light of them. Are offending them, you know, or saying things that shouldn't be said. You know, those things, they're not winning people. You're not trying to be a Christian, and the Lord will deal with you in those orders, because if you're doing it deliberately, then He will work upon you, because that's His way of doing it, all right? So don't do that. Don't be pulling apart, don't be doing it, don't make light of nobody, you know, because you make light of somebody, just remember, tomorrow somebody will make light of you. It may take a while before somebody does it, but then you'll feel bad and you'll realize, so just don't do it to nobody else. Why can't you just love each other, have a good time for the kids to be playing together, and oh, you got your buddies, you got your partners and playings, you know, and doings. All like that, and let me say it to you, I see a lot of you adults, it's even worse than the kids, too, because some of you adults won't even speak to each other hardly. Some of you probably hadn't shook hands with each other in 6 months. Well, we're all supposed to be in the body of Christ. If you notice, I don't stop with one person. You know what it is? Most pastors or preachers go out and get a little group. No, no, I go around and shake hands with every one of you. If I don't shake your hand on Sunday, it's not my fault. It's yours because you didn't hang around long enough for me to do that, because I want to be friends to everybody, because that way I want everybody to be friends to me, whether it be little kids, big kids, or whatever it be, that it be that way. All right? So just make everything and get all of your playing together and the right, and don't leave nobody out, and, you know, of your playings and your doings. Have a good time together and fellowship together and make it to be that way. Now I'm going to go ahead and mention this part too, because it's been mentioned to me about the youth camps. All right. I've had bad taste about youth camps that I don't like. And for some reasons, you know, things. But the church will pay for your children, the child's registration fee, for them to go to youth camp. But it won't pay for no adults to go to carry them, because that would be derogatory to some of the others that can't go, that would like to go and to do. So we just don't do it. But I said, now, if you take your child to youth camp, it's your responsibility to get them there, back home, and the doings. It's not our responsibility. We take no responsibility whatsoever for your child. If you don't want them to go to the youth camps, that's fine. If you want them to go, I'll say it again and keep saying it, we will pay the tuition fee, or what it costs, you know, the child to go and do. We'll pay that. But we won't pay for somebody else to take them, because if we pay for somebody to take them, we're responsible. The church van is set up to where there's only certain ones in the church can drive it. And the reason is because of the insurance. If you would be willing to go and do something, you might get on the insurance. But you know what you got to go? You got to go to 2 days of a driver's education. You got to have 2 days of it before you can qualify, or either linked, and they do, the insurance kind of allows the CDL license. They allow that part because that's the doings. But adults, see, it's just not a, it's not a whole bunch can drive the van. So we can't say, well, we're going to send a van to youth camp, because that way we're going to be taking the responsibility. You take your kids, do what you want to, take them to youth camp, do the things. We'll pay for the tuition, but not your expenses for mom and daddy to go or anybody else to go. We'll pay just for the kids' tuition, and then that way, if they go, you come to us. We'll give you the money for paying for that, but we will not pay for anybody to go and, you know, drop off your kids and go somewhere and visit with somebody else, because that doesn't, that leaves it. That's what I'm against some of the youth camps. Now, if I ever did run a youth, if I ever have anything to do with youth camps, which we did, all right, we had adults that were supposed to go along. And sometimes they didn't do it. And they got put off of it from me as to not do it anymore, because they didn't go and do the order the way I said it. I said, go there, be a director, be a youth counselor, be in with our children and make sure they behave themselves and do. A woman with the girls, band with the boys, all right? And all like that. So we tried to do those things, but to just solve the problem of any situations, if you want to take your kids to youth camp, you feel free to do. That's up to you. But we won't pay for nothing other than the child itself as the registrational fee. All right. Then that way, whatever you do, if you're taking them there and dropping them off, that's your responsibility. I would be very careful about the youth camps, you know, and all like that, because there can be problems happen. And you can't correct it. Like I was talking about a while ago, you run around here with a stick, or you get out here, kids, a lot of times, we'll be down, adults will be under the outside thing. And the kids, some of you older boys and girls come running through. Well, don't do that. You can hurt somebody. You can knock down one of these little bitty kids. And you knock somebody down, well, it wasn't my my fault. It is if you're running out there when you're not. And you could knock somebody, lose an eye, lose, make an arm broken, you could, and it'll never be repaired. So just don't do it. Don't come down. You know, we used to, we had the little kids, they would ride their little wheel. I made a mark and I said, don't bring that little stroller wheelie you're riding in no further than right here. Because adults was out there walking around. You know, try to be safe. It's a whole lot better to be safe than it is sorry. A couple of fellas here one time throwed some rocks and dent up a car. And you know what? They paid for the car to be fixed. So, if I was your moms and dads and I told you not to do it, you know, I said, don't do them things. Now, Brother Dale's instructed. If I was your daddy and you went out there and throwed a rock or throwed a ball, and, you know, accidents can happen, but if you do the wrong, you'd pay for it. Your allowance would be taken care of to make you pay for it, you know, because you're told not to do it. Try to be nice. Try to be Christians about everything. Have a good time. Hey, we don't throw off. You know, Brother Dale don't holler and scream about all these things like these other churches do. Hey, come on, folks. You older ones, I don't like what the kids are doing today. You had your ducktail haircuts and bell-bottom pants. Right? You had your day. And the things that was done in your day was just, and my day was just like the things the kids are doing now. You know, I have more trouble out of adults than I do kids because kids generally understand me. But, okay. Try to keep that right to where that you're not playing rough. You respect each other on the playgrounds and things. And you kind of stay to where you're supposed to be. The bigger kids are the bigger kids, you know, and the little ones are the little ones and the doings. And not be throwing off on things. And don't be throwing off on somebody else. Please don't. That's not even good sense, let alone Christianity. Christianity doesn't make light of anybody. You know, I went to school. None of you kids have never been there. My brother, when he was in school, they knew every day when he was walking down the hall because they took my daddy's shoes and cut the toes off and left him. And I've got the old wood, the old metal thing that you laid the shoe on, you know, and to beat it down. I've got that of my daddy's. And, you know, and they could hear him coming down the hall because he didn't have nothing but a big old heel and a little short thing on the front. But we was poor, you know. Sometimes people can't afford fancy clothes like others. Don't make fun of nobody because they can't. You know, no, don't do that. Don't make light of nobody about anything. Respect everybody as a person. I've always been able, when I worked at General Motors, I worked with a lot of people that was the first years that we had the mixed races into the black people coming in working at General Motors, you know, and all. I never had no trouble with any of them. Because I believe everybody's a human being. It don't matter about the color of your skin. You can't help the color of your skin. You can't help it being that way. But you can help what you do. You can help about all the other things, you know, or trying to be bigger than or better than somebody else. Just be yourself, all right? You know, and let it be nice and things, okay? A lot of things I guess we should cover, but just remember what we've said. You know, let it be a Christian attitude. Not making fun of somebody else. Because the minute you make fun of somebody else, the devil is going to have somebody make fun of you. And you're going to find it out. But it'll be too late. The best thing to do is just don't do it to start with. Don't be in any way, adults, children, or whatever, don't make fun of nobody because of their raisins and their doings and their clothes and their things. Just don't do it. It's not a good Christian attitude. But just have a good time, okay? All right. Take that. It's from Brother Dale and just... remember that we're trying to be a group of Christians living for Christ and trying to win people instead of running them off. And that way, then you can do it. All right. Now, we left off this morning, so we'll try to pick up part of the morning's message and continue on into what we're talking about. But what was the point we were talking about this morning that I kept emphasizing? And I want to keep on emphasizing that point to you, that the new birth, the prophet said you need the new birth more than anything in the world. All right? Because if you don't have the new birth, you're not born again. If you don't have the new birth, you're not going to be in heaven as the bride of Christ. You're not going to be in those things. You're going to be left out because you won't do it. All right? In that new birth, as we will cover and review a little bit, we saw that it does not take place in the body. It does not take place in the spirit. So that would do away with all of your things that you would try to depend upon as to call it your salvation. And you know that I'm right, that you ask most people, are you born again? And they'll tell you, you know, like, and then we kind of laugh at the one where Brother Branham said, you know, they said, well, something about, are you a Christian? Said, I'll have you know I burn a candle every night. Yeah. Well, see, we'd laugh and say, well, what has that got to do with it? But you know what? Somebody else is looking down the road to you to look at it, and you say, well, you know, are you a Christian? I speak in tongues. Well, somebody's looking down at that and saying that ain't right, because you can do that every day of your life and still be lost. Amen. Well, I believe the message. Now, there is a certain point there that is true. If you really believed, there wouldn't be any problem. Right. We'll have to cover that. That word believe is about that long, because it starts from just a knowledge and goes all the way to where even who would it, Job would say, I know. Right. He didn't say, I think or hope so. I know. Right. My Redeemer liveth. All right? But see, that new birth takes place in the soul, not in the body and the spirit. What you do outwardly of anything you can call it, right, speaking in tongues, shouting, crying, you know, and Brother Brown said, living, we read this morning, people living even a Christian life, he said. You know, living good, doing good, loving the Lord. Because, see, you don't love the Lord with your body. Amen. Right? You love the Lord with your spirit. Because your soul is either one of the two. Right. It would be love or it would be hate. Right. Because it has to be one of the two. It's either God or the devil. Right. All right? So really the love that we're interested in the thoughts is dealing with the realm that we call the spirit realm of mankind. The second realm of mankind, which is memory, reason, conscience, affections, and things. All right? And you can do every bit of that. Go to church all of your life. See, we didn't know that years ago, did we? We never heard that taught in an organizational religion. We could hear certain things, but not like that. See? It's not that form, because when the prophet came, I'll read, I think it was in this morning, or I'll read it this evening, he said, and you say you believe me as a prophet. In other words, he said, why don't you listen to what I'm saying? Right. Exactly. Right? If you say you believe him as a prophet, listen to what he says. All right? Because that's the only way that we can handle it. All right. And see, you could be anointed on your spirit with the genuine baptism of the Holy Spirit. Right. Now, I may hit it this afternoon, but I would advise you to listen for a few services. This is not just a 6 and 7 message of you must be born again. I warn you, this message has cost me a lot in sleep and everything else, because there's a lot of things that I know I'm responsible for explaining. All right? Because somewhere it's got to be explained for us to understand it. Well, I just believe it. What do you believe?
Right, that's it.
You know? What do you believe? You know, we really didn't know what we believed till the prophet came, right? We thought we believed a lot of things, you know? But it's kind of like Brother Branham said. He said, I used to think that Jesus loved me and God hated me. Now, he was honest enough to say it. But he said, I found out it was self-same person, you know? All right? But see, the new birth cannot take place in your body because the body without the spirit is dead. And if a new birth took place there, then it wouldn't matter about the spirit or whatever if it took place in the body. All right? Then it cannot take place in the spirit realm because then Satan can be there. All right? Now, remember, he is in the soul of us as a nature. Away, you know, until we're born again. But then when we're born again, he's not there anymore because he can't do it, and God won't dwell in an unclean vessel. So don't think that it's God and the devil in there together. Now, when Brother Branham explained it, he didn't put it that way. He said, in me now is two dogs, white dog, black dog. All right. That don't mean the devil is in your soul. That's one thing I've taught from the beginning with you. That the devil can't be in your soul at the same time God's there. That won't work. All right? Because that would mess up the entire Bible. All right. Now, I say this because somebody on the tape could click on. We are using the points of what the prophet is going to be saying in the opening of the word, in the basis that he would talk about body, spirit, and soul. When is his early ministry, he would interrelate that sometimes and bring it that away. But the basics, he would bring it as body, soul, and spirit. All right. But he didn't have to correct it. Because he wasn't wrong in the senses of that. He always gave the body, see, taste, feel, smell, and hear. He always gave the second realm, whether he called it soul or spirit or being or what. It was always memory, reason, conscience, and affection. All right? And he always gave the center realm one sense, either faith or doubt, either God or the devil, you know. He always kept it lined up, so he didn't have to come back, well, I don't know where he corrected that at. Well, go on over after the opening of the seals and just read, and you'll find out. And then in no way am I saying, was he wrong back there? That's what I'm saying. Maybe it was left to blind a lot of people because a lot of your doctrines are based upon the early ministry and not understanding the getting together. To me, I believe he was a prophet in the old, you know, his early ministry, and he was a prophet in the later ministry. But I believe the word opened to the prophet. All right? I believe as he progressed, the word opened into it. That would be Hebrews 4:12. See, and that would be, I believe that's right where it says it brings it to the point of dividing soul and spirit. Joint and marrow. All right? The scripture then would be correct because in no way could you say the spirit that sinneth it shall die. The Bible don't say that. The Bible says the soul that sinneth shall die. All right? We need to deal a lot about this spirit realm to think about it as to be in the basis that where Satan has his greatest hand into or dwells the most. Right? And don't ever think, as the prophet said, that in any way that we are, any of us, a match for the devil.
Amen. Right.
Just get that plain. There's no way for us to be a match for the devil. Now, the baptism of the Holy Ghost is a match for the devil.
Amen.
But you got to admit, a lot of times we don't yield to that. If you don't, you're going to find it out, you know, eventually. But see, we say God tells us this and God tells us that. Right?
That's right.
And see, then that way we base everything upon something that we believe as to be what God does. Well, what if that's not true? You know, what if it's the devil that was telling us that? And what even, as it we were covering there in one service, what even if it is that God allows these things to come among you to try you to see whether or not you will stay with the truth?
Right?
See, then you got to go back to the Word. You can't go nowhere else. We'll get around to that, right? Because you know what I believe. What is the new birth, Brother Dale? It's the Word revealed to you personally. Right? Because it can't be anything else. It can't be shouting, speaking in tongues, crying. All them things is good. But the new birth takes place in the soul of man, and then outwardly, the spirit displays what's in the soul, and the body displays what the spirit is doing. All right? But the main thing is that inside of the inside. Now, that's what we're going to be talking about a little bit when we get down to it in a minute. But I want you to just think about it, and we're going to drop back to the morning message, pick up number 7, brothers, which will be coming from the future home. All right? And I want us to read this because to me it's a wonderful expression of truth. And to me it takes out a lot of ideas and things that people have had. You know, they're saying now, and the people of the message are saying, well, the new birth now is just a baptism. Well, you can have that on your spirit and die and go to hell. Now what do you got? Oh, but you don't understand what we're talking about, baptism. I agree with you. I don't understand what you're talking about on baptism. I mean, I agree with you. I have no problem. Because to me, baptism is baptism. One of these days, I'm going to show you or preach to you what I believe the new birth is. I haven't preached it in 40-something years. There's been a secret was left there that I couldn't explain. And there's still a lot of things I can't explain. But I wait on him. All right? Go look what he says. He said, first time Christ ever dealt with me, coming down, such a boy, I've always taught those three stages of grace. Now, why is it now that they're saying that he taught different stages, different things? It means they're not saying he's the prophet. See, he's always taught three processes. This is 1964. See, to you that believe, you'd believe after the seals, but not before. So. But just remember that point. And look what he says now, and I love this because to me it explains my Christian journey. It explains my new birth and what took place to me. So if nothing else, bear with me reading what took place to me. You may have got this, you just jumped right up and just whammo and got everything. I'm not saying you didn't. But I am saying one thing. If you have the new birth, you had to come through three stages to get it. Now, he's going to explain those three stages, justification, sanctification, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You say, well, Brother Dale, you've always told us that when you came into the message that you had been a Baptist, a deacon, and all kind of things, and teachers of all, but said you found out you wasn't born again. Well, you know what? This is the way I found it out. I found it out by reading a man talking about an experience. And just remember, Brother Branham says, one of the mysteries is to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost without a sensation. But he never said to have a new birth or anything without an experience. An experience is something you live through. A sensation is a stimulation upon your flesh, out through from your spirit realm. Right? So then listen and see if this is what happened to you. And maybe you'd say, well, I don't remember that happening to me. Well, maybe you need to follow the channel and let that happen.
Amen. Right.
I mentioned one time not too long ago, and I got one person to agree, that what if I come out here one day and said, I think that everybody in here ought to get baptized again. I said 98% of the people would say, I was baptized right to start with, and I don't need to get baptized again. But what is it if you do? I baptized a lot of people that was baptized correctly. Because they come and said, I didn't understand. I didn't know. I didn't follow that. Well, okay. You see? You bless God, I've been baptized correctly. Now, why are you getting upset? Right? I ain't. Why are you getting all boiled over about something? Well, you're just trying to get us to do something again. I've been baptized 3 times. One time in a river right down here, and over there where they got that new bridge at Gillsville. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Good old Baptist. Went back and heard of this message, and we were planning to go over there, and they used to have a lot of baptisms at that creek. Because the day we were planning to go back, the best I remember, there were 2 church groups standing in line waiting to baptize at that river. That's the best I can remember it now. And Brother Moat said, well, what are we going to do? I said, I don't have to be baptized in the same water because it don't make no difference. But I said, I do know where that same water runs good and deep. So we drove back up 1/4 mile, turned, went down in the woods, went to the same creek. I got baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We went to Israel, and out of 26, I believe it was, 24 probably believers of the message, my wife and I and Brother Dean and Sister Peggy Gibby, we were the only 4 that got baptized in the River Jordan. A lot of them said, I've been baptized correctly. I don't, what are y'all getting baptized again for? I said, if I come back again, I'll do it again. Don't bother me. I ain't denying nothing. I love it. I'm kind of like old Brother Willie Ross that I heard him telling, and most of you remember him, but he said he went up to Jeff the first time, and I believe it was Brother Solomon was with him, wasn't it? And they had said something about getting baptized, and they had been baptized correctly. He said, now, Willie said, now, Solomon, you just keep your mouth shut. We're going to get some more of this. They wanted to be baptized again. All right. But you see, but get back to the story. See, he said he'd always taught 3 stages of grace. Well, now, anything you read anywhere, if that statement is correct, then line it up to that statement. Right. And then now he's going to explain there's 3 stages. See? And that way you'll keep it correct. Now watch, he starts then. He says, now the first step is repentance towards God. Then follows after that is water baptism. Water baptism, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. See? Water baptism follows, showing that repentance was genuine. Well, when I found out I was baptized wrong, I didn't have any trouble saying I want to make it right. right? Because I wanted it to be, and then I found out the name and all of the things. But watch what he says. Showing that the repentance was genuine. Now, you can talk people into a lot of things.
Yep. Right. That's right.
And I believe that's what happens to a lot of people. And it's not a genuine repentance.
Right.
Now, because, see, we could spend days on this teaching. See, do you know what a genuine repentance is? The Bible says, the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Right? The Bible says, no one can come to the Father but by me. Is that what Jesus said? If I misphrase just a hair, you put it right in order. You know. But it's pretty close to the scripture. See, nobody can come unless they're called. But then we've got another scripture that many are called, and what? Few are chosen. Now we're still in the Bible. All right? See, showing that you're genuine. In other words, genuine repentance. It means you realize that you were wrong.
Amen.
And you're sorry for that.
Right.
Now, words are cheap until you go to a lawyer. It's going to cost a far out of you. But words are cheap. I'm sorry.
Yep.
Well, now if we keep going back and doing things over and over again, saying I'm sorry don't work too good.
Right.
Right. Okay. Showing that repentance was genuine or to remit our past sins that has nothing to do with the future. Now, we know for a certainty that water baptism does not remit. So he's not explaining of a remittance of sin. Right here is where it's remitted. It's remitted at genuine repentance. We'll get to that if we get to Ezekiel. If we don't, we'll have it later. Where he talks about a new heart. I'll take away your stony heart. Well, we didn't get no heart transplant. Right?
Right.
All right. You see, are to remit our past. In other words, it shows our past are gone. Not the baptism. The repentance shows our doing, but the remittance and following the baptism shows that my remittance, my sincerity of being genuine. That's what's remitting my sins. All right? See, that has nothing to do with your future sins.
Right.
So justification chops off your past sins. It has nothing to do with your future. You're still just as lost as can be other than your repentance and your believing.
Right.
You might qualify for a foolish virgin. That's between God and you.
Right.
But see, it don't have nothing to do. See, it only remits. Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. What for? Remission. Now, there's another word. Remission. Because showing that it's written. What? Taking away the past sin has nothing to do with the future. Just your sins has been chopped off what you did.
Right.
You can't repent for what Adam done. You never done it. Adam did. You just get forgiveness for what you've done. The old nature is still there.
Right.
All right. Now, you can argue the point of back in Luther's day and how that much they got it, but Brother Branham said Luther got the new birth. I just found that one the other day. I'd always known that where he said the new birth of Wesley under sanctification. But Luther got the new birth.
Right.
But they wasn't as much required then as they are now.
Right.
But I believe Luther was required to repent.
Right.
And get things straight.
Right.
All right? Now watch what he says. Then he goes up and he makes a board and he illustrates on the blackboard.
Right.
And here is a human heart. And here is a human heart. Now, I'm as honest as I can be. This is what I believe. That's not two hearts. That's the same heart. But it's showing the stages of the heart.
Right.
If you're going to make it two people, that's fine. Make it one person over here got this, one person got this. But if you're going to make it down to one person, bring it down to think about what happens. And you'll see a beautiful picture. All right? Now, this one over here has a snake in it. That's sin. So he drawed it out, and the little line drawn in the snake, you know. Here he has his life. That's the center part. All right? This one over here has a dove in it, which is the Holy Spirit. Here he has a life. Well, this one here. See, going back. He has malice, hatred, envy. That's what's causing it, is this fella here. Something inside of there is causing it. Inside of that drawing he made of a heart is causing these things to have hatred, envy, malice. This one over here has love and joy and long-suffering. That's what does it down here. And when you are asked, are you are forgiven of your sins, you only done this, taken that away. So you can take, if you drawed it out with a snake, and you drawed little squiggly lines to represent sin, and then you drawed the inside core of the person. Now, he says what you've done is you just released them sins. See, when you repent of your sins, that's your past. You can't repent of your future. You're going to have to wait until that comes. We're not Catholicism in trying to be penance. No. You can't get forgiven of something you ain't done yet. Right? Why do you do it? Ask forgiveness. For heaven's sake, don't try to be what they're saying. Lord, help me. I'm going to go do it. No, that won't work. And watch. You only done this, taken that away. But the thing that made you do it is still there. Okay? Yep. That's the old root of evil. It's still there. Notice. Now, brother, Jesus said the unclean spirit goeth out of the man. He's talking about the root of evil. And Brother Brown says that the unclean spirit goes out at sanctification. So that's solving the problem. Amen. Notice then you repent and are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ that he forgave you of your sins. Notice, then secondly comes sanctification, which sets our mind in order for holiness to think right. Now, remember this morning we were explaining the jar in the yard. You pick it up. You got a reason for doing it. You don't go put every stuff in it. You take it in the house and you wash it real good. Then you go put something in it. Justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost. All right? Secondly comes sanctification, which sets our mind in order for holiness to think right. Take away. Sanctification is a compound word. Now, don't confuse this mind with the mind of Christ. And don't worry about making the mind too much in relation, because your memory, reason, conscience, and affection does work through your mind. Right? All right. Sanctification is a compound Greek word, which means cleanse and set aside for service. Then next comes the baptism of fire, and I love that. I love it greatly, because when we get around to some of the other things the prophet has said, that is going to become a very valuable scripture. Because the Bible says the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. See, Brother Run says baptism of fire and Holy Ghost. The Bible says baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. It's going to be needful when we get up there to talking about it. So I would hold on to that. See, that God might dwell in us, and the fire of God cleanses our hearts from sin and puts the Holy Ghost inside. Then we bring forth the same life that this did, because that's in us. Now watch what he's saying. Pull it back down. Pull it back down just a little bit. All right. Cleanses our heart from sin and puts the Holy Ghost inside. Then we bring forth the same life that this did. All right. That Holy Ghost is the life of God coming into you. All right. Now I ask you a question. How can God be in you? You must consider this valuable to think about. How can God get into you, into your soul? Leave the point, will you? Way on down the road. Maybe next weekend if we get there. But watch, roll it up. We keep on reading a little bit because it goes through the spirit and the when a woman gives a birth in the natural birth, type of the spiritual birth. The baby's born into the kingdom of God. He comes the same way, water, blood, spirit. Now notice sanctification, the third stage. Now watch him. Second stage of it. Cleanses the mind, sets the heart, the mind of the heart in order of holiness. Mind of the heart. Brain, thumping gizzard. No, not exactly. Because that ain't the things he's working on. A man can repent of sins and still thinking. Remember, repentance does nothing to your future, just the past. Well, he's an immoral man or immoral looking woman he finds is still there. Maybe he's a drunkard. Every time he smells the drink, it's still there, see? But then when he gets sanctified, that cleanses that desire out of him. It takes a want of it away. Watch, he can still be tempted, but it takes a want of it away. Still, he's not right yet. Then he is baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire, cleansed, burned out, cleaned up, and then put it into the service of God. Sanctification only sets them aside for service. Right. Now, I'll go ahead and drop a key. When it says Holy Ghost and fire, that's not incorrect the way it's placed. But your mind tries to translate that as working. And it looks like the Holy Ghost and the fire coming. But just remember, even though the unclean spirit has gone out, you're still not right yet. And we will quote the prophet this way. There's telltale signs of Satan still left, even though you've been sanctified. Because what do you got? You can't go no further than the work that's been done. Who are you if the unclean spirit has gone out? You're a clean vessel. But to make sure that's right, the prophet says you do change it to fire and Holy Ghost. For your understanding that the fire cleanses everything that's left. That's why there's not a lot of new births. See, in Samuel Dale, it was supposed to take out all of those wrong things. The fire is to burn it out. Now you see why that when I heard the truth, I remember when I repented. Don't you? I remember the things that we all talk about, that a great load of sin went off of your shoulders and you become a different person. But you know that, and we'll quote Brother Branham somewhere in a few minutes, he said, see him turn around in a month from now and be gone. Amen. Right. Why? Because there's nothing to hold you. Right. I remember when the things of life begin to come to a stage in me back in the Baptist that I wanted to get rid of those things. But I had no one I could talk to about it because they didn't understand my wordings, and I don't understand that. I tried to explain it to a lot of people that, hey, there's just still things wrong. And I'd like to know why. All right? I'd like to know how come things are still working. Don't you? I like answers to questions. Yes, sir. And my question has been to you as a church is what? If you are truly a born-again Christian, sealed by the Holy Spirit, you know, truly have it now. And you do something wrong, who's doing the wrong? Can't be the soul because it's eternal. But it's got to be your spirit realm. You remember that? We've been through this a long time. Talking about this sanctification, it's the most dangerous stage that there is, because that anointing can come upon you and you will think you're Christians. You will go out and preach the gospel. You'll go out and see the sick healed, the dead raised, the things. Judas had part of the ministry of Jesus Christ. And see, it's very easy then to let those things get in your way. I told a man one time, talking to him, I said, your problem is you've got a gift. And I know his gift work. I'm not to explain nothing, I just tell you, all right? I know his gift worked and works. But I said, that's your problem. Brothers here can tell you about a certain brother that we all know, not all of us, but some of us know him. He can pray for the sick and they're healed. And he's still smoking his pot and probably drinking everything or whatever it is. And his problem is that, you know what? That he's looking at people who claim to be Christians that can't do what he's doing. And he says, God must love me more than he does you. Now, you going to argue with him? Hey, he's got too many things stacked on his side for you to argue the point with him, because he can pray for the sick and they're healed. Brother Mold, I remember that years ago. I never will forget it, that he was talking about this Russian monk, that this guy was a head thing in Russia. And every time that the man's boy had some kind of disease, some of you that know Brother Mode a long time heard that story, I'm sure. And every time that baby would get violently sick with that, he would call this guy up, and the guy could be on a dance floor, drunk as a coot. Stop, get down and pray, and God heal the child. I believe it. Because that's gifts and callings without repentance. You don't repent to get a gift. You're either born with one or you don't get one. You don't train for a gift. You don't exercise something to make it a gift. You either got one or don't got it. Not good English, but it's the best way of saying it. All right? But what are you going to say to a person that they say, but I've prayed for 10, 12, 15 people and they were healed? How many of you ever prayed for and seen get healed? They got you over a barrel if you don't know the truth. Because they're telling you a truth. See? Well, I just don't believe that happened. I'm not going to argue that point. That's what I told the brother. I said, your gift is your problem. Because you see things. And maybe I don't see things like that. Well, it can be a hindrance to you, because you think you're greater into that point. That's gifts. That's what I was talking about this morning. You can be anointed with a genuine baptism of the Holy Ghost. Signs and wonders take place, and inside you're still lost. That, you tell me that's easy understood, I'm going to tell you I don't believe so. But when Brother Branham began to explain those things, I knew I didn't have what he's talking about. My repentance was genuine. I believe that. My sanctification, I didn't know to call it that or whatever it was back then. But I did, you know, get to where that I didn't care for those things and was trying to live a Christian life, to be honest and sincere, you know, and to do. One illustration, and it'll solve a lot of problems. I sold a house one time. And I made an agreement, handshook with my nephew. He paid, told me, he hadn't paid me or nothing. He just shook my hand and he said, I said, I'll take so many $1,000 for the house there in Gillsville. He shook my hand. I said, it's yours. A couple of days later, my brother came to me and said, I'll give you $5,000 profit. That's a lot of money back then. So that would have been 1971, two. That's a lot of money. Still a lot of money to me. Might not be to you, but it's still a lot to me. He said, I'll give you $5,000 profit. I said, no, you don't understand. It's done sold. He said, well, what's that got to do with it? You ain't signed no papers. I said, look, my word is my bond. It is sold. And you know what he even done? He went and talked to my brother about it, brother's brother, and he come back or told me later, he said, they said, you're a dummy. Go ahead and do it, and they'll divide it. That's the one I sold it to. He said, just go ahead and sell it to him. Me and you get $2,500 a piece. I said, no, the house is yours. That was the way I lived and have tried to live because I believe that away. Richard was talking about a while ago going in the store, and he could have walked away with about $150 worth of stuff, and nobody could have done anything. But he went back in and paid the people. Are you trying to live that honest and sincere? That had a lot to do with it. Right. But you see, I believe my sanctification was good back there. Because you know what? It brought me to this message. Amen. Yep. By studying the Word and letting the Word cleanse me and set me aside brought me to this message. But then when the prophet began to talk about that baptism of the Holy Ghost, not as a, when he'd say, it's not shouting, it's not crying, it's not doing, it's none of these things. He said, it's the person of Jesus Christ coming living in you. I got to admit, there's something wrong. You know, when I began to seek God, and for 2 years I sought him before I come to an experience that was satisfactory to me. You know, what did you do? No, I can tell you great things happened in my experience, but none of them do I count a new birth. We'll get to that. But look what he's saying. First is repentance toward God. Follow it into baptism. Do what it says. Sanctification. Sanctification cleansing you and setting you aside. The unclean spirit going out. That devil going out of that heart, as I said, is drawn for one with the devil in it and the other one with a dove in it. Just put them together and put the dove over in there. I'm not a doctrinal issue of a point, trying to make a point. See, sanctification is to cleanse that desire out of you. It takes the want of it away. You can still be tempted, but takes the want of it away. You're still not right yet. Nope. Right, ma'am. Now, we'll try to drop over and pick up the evening message now, okay? You see, Questions and Answers on the Seals, 1963, paragraph 52. You see, each one of those ages only taking a dip into the Holy Spirit. Justification is a work of the Holy Spirit. Sanctification is a work of the Holy Spirit. But the baptism is the Holy Spirit. That's why you can be justified and sanctified and still be lost. Because the baptism is the Holy Spirit that comes into you. And where does it work at? It works in your soul. You're not justified, sanctified, and baptized with the Holy Ghost only body or spirit. I hope this has been enough for that to have gotten away from your thinking. But to think about that the new birth is the birth of the soul. Then the justifications and the thing work back out of that soul in through the body, through the spirit. And other people can see that. You can deceive people, right? But you can't deceive God. Because it'll come to the right place. And the one thing it'll come to, you'll find this out eventually, it'll come down to a basis one day that you're going to be dealing with what the Word says. And then you'll make up your mind whether you're right or not. You'll decide then whether you're right or not. But what is it? The new birth is in the soul. And being that new birth in that soul is dealing not with just justification and sanctification. That's part of it. And must be there. Just as it is, the baby must start the process of rejection or ejecting from the body, and the water breaks, and then the blood, and then the baby. All right. The baby's the main thing. The other things are not as important. But yet, that second, I hope you'll think about sanctification is the stage in your life that you want to go to church, that you want to do what's right. And that you'll think about, well, you know, I haven't felt God's presence lately. And the prophet said sometimes it was because the Holy Spirit had to go out on a limb and get away from you. That don't mean you lost. But what if it is that you're just justified and sanctified? So you got to make your choice as your answer. And your answer will determine your destination. Let's just read a few quotes, all right? Let's start off number one on the evening message. And watch what the prophet says on the power of transformation. All right. 1965, 1031, paragraph 311. That little inside of the inside, that's where you start, which is your soul. Then come from that your spirit. Then you become a living being. Now, the living being has sense, five senses to contact. The second has five senses. That's the outside body, see, taste, feel, smell, and hear. The inside body has love, conscience, and so forth, five senses. But inside of the inside, the control tower, it's either God or Satan. And you can mimic any of these things you can contact. That sounds like, you know, what do you mean? You can't say what he meant, but I can say one thing for sure. He said you can mimic anything that you get around and learn of. Anything you contact, you can mimic it, right? Brother Gary was here. He can talk like everybody in this building. Because he can mimic it. So you can mimic anything that you're around. Is that sensible what he's saying? All right. Like a Christian. Or you could cast out devils like a Christian. But the inside control tower, the beginning, the origin, isn't of God. It'll never return to God. You understand? Did not Judas cast out devils? Did not Caiaphas, the one who condemned him and put him to death, even prophesy? Right. But he couldn't stay with the Word. He couldn't do that. Yep. But he had everything else. Look what he says on this inside of the inside. Works his faith expressed. Paragraph 207. And notice it's got to be F-E-I-T-H. Outside, spirit, J-E-S-U-S, on the inside, Y-O-U. Now, that's how standing here looking at you. Now, watch him. He's explaining his gift, but look what he says. That's how standing here looking at you. He had the new birth, right? Yeah, come on, you agree he had the new birth, right?
Amen.
But watch it. That's how standing here looking at you. I don't know a one of you. Well, he just didn't know him. Oh, okay. The Spirit can anoint me, still I don't know none of you. But when the inside of the inside breaks in, that's God. You want me to give you a quote that astounded me when I first remember it? He said, you know this discernment that I have? You remember what he called it? He said, it's a revelation. He said, this discernment I have, if you want to quote it, I'll be glad to find it. I wouldn't be making it if I didn't know. He said, it's a revelation. Well, how are you going to fool with a revelation? You see why he's so certain about that gift that he had and what he was doing? He didn't fool with it. He didn't make it work. It worked him. Right? That's where the outside can reason. You take a man and say, well, you know, I know if I'm not supposed to commit adultery. But you know, then the Spirit tells me I shouldn't commit adultery. But you see, way down in there is still that thing in there. See? It'll kind of govern around and better watch it. But when it's directed from the inside, it throws all the rest of it together. That's the guidepost. That's the control tower. The inside of the inside. The soul controls the spirit. The spirit controls the body. Soul and outside whitewash don't make any difference. Them religious people back there that Paul called whited walls and so forth, they were outward. Just every way a believer, and they had prophecies among them and everything else, but the inside of the inside, the soul that disbelieve it. That's the reason I say people can jump up and down and speak in tongues. People can shout, lay hands on the sick, and heal the sick and so forth by faith. Gifts, right? By faith. All these great things by the Spirit still be lost, anointed ones. All right? Are you following me? Look at the next one. We'll get a couple of these, and then I'll drop off and make the next message out of these. Look what he says on leadership. Now, look, I'm a Pentecostal, you say. I'm this, or whatever you are. I profess to dance in the Spirit. But, Brother Branham, I thought as long as we had that, we had it. You haven't. Is that the way he's saying it? See, the man said, I thought as long as we had that, we had it. He said, you haven't. If you believe me to be God's prophet, you listen to my words. See? That's a deception in this day. Didn't the Bible say it'd be so close it would deceive the very elect, if possible, the elected down to the soul? Yeah. But if you dance in the Spirit, still with the things of the world, there's something wrong. If you speak with tongues, Paul said, I can speak with tongues of men and angels and still not even be saved. Uh-huh. Both kinds, see? I can do all the emotions. I can have faith. I can preach the gospel. I can give all my goods to feed the poor. I can carry the word in the mission fields across and still I'm wrong, see? And it's that inside of the inside, brother. Your spirit breaking up when you die, it takes its flight, but your soul lives. What about it? Inside of the inside. I'll drop back on this Wednesday, but I want to get one little point in. I'm not Wednesday, next Sunday. He said, Brother Dale, do you believe that a truly born again Christian can do wrong, do things wrong? Certainly do. You're not supposed to go out and keep doing it all the time. All right. We can go with that. But you tell me you don't never have a wrong thought. Right. You tell me you never have a wrong thought whatsoever. I just beat you to the point and I'll call you a liar. Because if that's what I said, that's what I'd be. Be a liar. Huh? See, Jesus had wrong thoughts. Do you agree? Did not the devil tempt him in all forms? Turn this into bread, do this, that, do that, and the other. And Brother Brown said, even tempted the women. Now, that's his statement trying to make Jesus into the wrong person, but to show him how human that he was. Now, remember, his body was created a virgin birth. His spirit was a spirit in sundry times and divers manner. So then the devil could still tempt him in his spirit realm. That's why in his spirit realm, dropping back to the word that was within him, he turns and he says, get behind me. He never denied none of his thoughts and ideas. Just get behind me. Don't ever think you'll get to the place that you cannot be tempted. Because you would be wrong. But a true Christian, where do you do wrong at? Your body would display what the unbelief or thoughts or, you know, mad or words you would say or something would come through your body, through the vocal cords. But that spirit within you can cause you to do those things.
Right.
And you still even be a truly born-again Christian.
Right.
Now, I'm as honest as can be. I said it to start with, I have wrong thoughts. Well, you know, if I didn't believe it that way, I would be the most horrible person in this building, and I would sit down right now and never preach again. If I can't leave it to the basis that I do have a sensible answer, that within my soul, God cannot, as John said, his seed remaineth in it.
Right.
And the seed cannot sin. He didn't say the person.
Exactly.
The seed can't. If you ever get to the basis that you say, I don't do anything wrong, just remember the devil's already got you right in the middle of his traps right where he wants you. Why do we need an advocate if we don't do wrong? Come on, folks. Prophet, do you sin? He said, every day. See, that's why we got to have the advocate. After you're born again is when you get the advocate. You don't get the advocate before you're born again. The Holy Ghost is the I can't even pronounce the word. That Holy Ghost inside of you, he's the one that takes care of all the things. You see, one of these days, maybe it'll dawn on us, a lot of the things is really Bible. Where it says, the Spirit maketh intercession with words that cannot be spoken. What's he making intercession for if I ain't doing wrong? Come on. Well, Brother Dale, it sounds like you mean you just go out and live like the devil. I try not to. You know, I try to fight him a little. I've always tried my best to tell you, and when you get to be 75 years old, you'll find it out. When I retired from General Motors, I said, I'm not going to sit down. Because if I go home and sit down, my arthritis and all them boogers that I've got all these years, they're going to take me and I ain't going to be able to move. So I'm going to fight him. If he gets this body, he's got to struggle. If you don't do that, you're giving in to him. That's why to me, I don't have no problem to go to the doctor. He said, how you doing? I said, I'm doing wonderful. I finally got convinced. I got to tell him. They said, well, doctor, the reason I'm up here, I got a bad cold. Or my legs are hurting. Help me get rid of this. But I'm simply saying, by stripes, I'm healed. And for all of these years, I stood with that to work, the hurting. But I still say, I'm healed. You keep confessing your healing. You know what? Something, you just might one of these days get a good revelation and it work. You know what? But if you don't confess it, how can it work? Hey, is that not what it is with salvation? That you must confess that you're saved before you can be saved. You must confess that you're healed before you can be healed. You know, somebody one of these days is going to say, I'm already changed. You know what? God's going to make that manifest and just take somebody into the change. But you know what? We can sit around, well, we're all in bad shape. You're in bad shape, I'm in bad shape. We're all in bad shape. Poor little petty thing. Brother Gary's daddy said, man walks into my office, I'm paraphrasing it. He said, I want him to have a positive attitude. You can deal with somebody who's got a positive attitude. Right. But if you got a total negative attitude, how can anybody help you? Now, you ain't never heard this statement. They're dying because they've give up. You never heard that? Because they give up. Now, you know what they call it? Hospice. Because hospice comes in, and what do? They can give you a way on a more pain medicine than a regular doctor. They can give you all kind of drugs that a regular doctor can't give you. Why? Because you already give up. He was laughing a while ago about it. Brother Aaron was telling about somebody been 18 months on hospice. Now, have you ever heard of that? They'll figure after a while that old fella ain't give up, wherever it is. They'll quit. They'll say, get out of here. You ain't give up yet. Being give out's one thing, but giving up's a lot of difference. What do you think about the new birth? I hope these things have been, come on, brothers, been some instructive thoughts. Amen. To where we can understand. How is it the person of Jesus Christ can come in you and live in you? See, your mind automatically goes to an anointing that is just a spirit. It's just a baptism of the spirit. Oh, we want to put it all on there. But you know, there's a lot of quotes where Brother Brown talks about you can have the baptism of the Spirit and still not be right. He said, because that's only for power and placing you in the body. You see, we got a long ways to go. I just hope there's enough time. Well, you shouldn't make them statements. Well, one of these days I got to. See, we think we get it all figured out. Somebody comes along that knows a little bit about what they're talking about, and it's mass confusion. Well, you know what? I know a little bit about electricity. I've wired that panel. I've done it. I can wire a whole house. I can do all about it. But I sure ain't gonna talk to Einstein. You know what? I ain't going to talk to Aaron about it either. We when he gets in them numbers that have no numbers that are numbers. Fugitive numbers or whatever you call them. Imaginary numbers. I ain't going to talk to him. But I will talk to you about what I do. You know, what I know. First time I went to Jamaica, my wife told him, said, well, honey, as much as you know about all of those things, said, you can help them do a lot of things. I got over there and I walked back and I looked at their wiring. And I looked at the panel and I said, ain't going to touch it. Because they start off dealing with 220. They do. And they say if we get all of ours on a 220, it could have half your bill. Because it costs you that much to down it to 110. I ain't going to touch it. But now you explain it to me in simple terminologies for a minute, then I'll do with them. I just hope the gospel's that way. Let's stand. Somebody to explain this little something to you. What we got, boys? Come and dine. Anybody have a need?
Jesus has a table spread
where the saints of God are met. He invites his chosen people. Come and dine with his manna he doth feed.
Supplies our every need.
Won't it sweep the sun with Jesus all the time? Come and dine,
the master calling.
Come and dine in that feast that
Jesus.
What do you think about? What do you think about salvation? God thought enough for you to give his own life. May I quote the prophet? If there was just one person in the world that wanted to be saved, let's paraphrase with close. He said he'd still climb on the cross and die. For one person. And you're that person.
Come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. Who the hungry heart. Come and dine. To be ever at his side.
Anybody have a need?
Jesus, they will feast eternally. Come and dine, the master calling. Come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the monster turned the water into wine. Do the hungry heart. Come and dine.
Forgive me, my voice is gone, but they can sing it. What we got? One more, boys.
I know it was the blood, page
171. I know it was the blood. It's 171. That is. Mm-hmm. It was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood.
It was Emmanuel's blood.
thoughts, he died upon the cross.